people not to disappear into Tibet or Russians coming down from Tibet. So he drew an imaginary, what he called a Indian line, actually a line parallel to the border, and that became the benchmark. Nobody can cross this inner line or go inside. And later on it turned out to be that when you cross the inner line, you ought to have a permit to go in. And that permits were issued by bureaucracy. And we call it sort of, this is the Lord Curzon's elephant. It walks very slowly, it's very strong, and it eats lots of people. You must supply them enough that what they want, and then possibly, you know, he'll start moving and digest something and sort of give it to you. And there are various reasons that the things sort of change. Towards the 70s, 80s, it was quite relaxed, and at least for Indians, we could easily get a permission as long as you prove you are homeless, and they would let you go. And for the foreigners also, the climbing permits were not so difficult as it is now. But then sometimes we climbers also misbehaved. That was the problem. For example, there was one Dutch expedition which was given permission to climb in Arunachal Pradesh, which is even still prohibited. This expedition went into an area where they were not supposed to go. They sort of fooled his liaison officer and went in. So they were caught, they were brought back, and government was angry, and then came the regime of X visa. Now if you want to climb in India, you have to obtain an X visa issued by in America. I mean, you have to apply here, and then here the IMF and the government of India will process it and send a telex or a fax to your embassy in New York, and that embassy will issue an X visa. So this X visa provision has been established because of this one major mischief that was done. And there is a book, Remo, written by Peter Hiller, even Australians who are climbing in the same restricted area on the other side. Now the book mentions that they were delayed in Leh for about 2 weeks because of permit problem. Then they went shifted to Sasoma, where they were wait for another 3 weeks. And one of the army general officer commanding visited him, and he assured him, but they were not sort of very happy about it. And with a liaison officer, when they walked onto the area which was next to the Chinese, there were soldiers put on both sides, and they were saying, look straight, don't look to the right, left, no photography. When they reached the Daulat Beg Oldi, a vast plateau, established a camp, army put up a sentry and looking over them. And when they came back, they were sort of stopped in middle of the entire plateau, and their luggage was checked for any photography. When they finally came down towards Khardugla, and they were climbing up, there was a blockage and everybody had to carry luggage. And in between, the book writes that we were carrying luggage and our liaison officer just waited there, and finally when we asked him to carry the luggage, he picked out a machine gun and said, alright, I apologize, otherwise I'll shoot you. So reading that book, published by Hodder and Stoughton, Australia, I came to conclusion that this is not the way our Indian army behaves. There must be something more to it. And armies generally do not correspond with foreigners. As you saw, they treat them as spies. So what it transpired was that this Australian expedition had applied to go by a little shorter route, which is away from the Chinese border, along the Shar to Gapshan and climb Remo. And after reaching there, they had not done their studies well. So they wanted to go by a longer route, which was within a kilometer of the Chinese border. And this would be considered as a fresh application by government of India, but they do not know who is he, what is he. So all those applications flew here and there. In between, Australians added their girlfriends into the team. So that also became another criteria to do things.